With just 1 month to go until the Brighton and Hove Council elections, concerned residents are asking candidates from all the political parties to pledge to make the city pesticide-free if elected. Mark Walker spoke to a representative from Pesticide Action Network UK to find out more.
So I'm joined here today by Josie Cohen from the Pesticide Action Network. Welcome to Latest News.
Thank you.
So you're making sure that pesticides are towards the top of the agenda for the local elections, aren't you?
Yeah.
You're speaking to the main political parties.
Yeah, absolutely. So today, with exactly a month to go until the council elections across Brighton and Hove, we're formally launching our campaign for a pesticide-free city. And what we're asking is that candidates standing of all political parties take our pesticide-free pledge. In other words, committing that if they're elected, they'll work towards making the city pesticide-free.
Yeah, and what does that mean, being pesticide-free in practice? What does that look like on the ground?
So the council sprays pesticides. Most people actually think of pesticides as just in agriculture.
Yeah.
But actually, a lot of chemicals are used just to control weeds in urban spaces, and that counts for cities across the UK, including Brighton and Hove. So the council is spraying pesticides to control weeds in parks and green spaces, playgrounds, around hospitals and schools, pavements, around shopping centres, housing estates. So they're very widely used, but actually, pesticide use in an urban setting is completely unnecessary. Lots of towns and cities have already gone pesticide-free because they're so concerned about the health and the environmental impacts of these chemicals.
And you've worked with Lewis Council, haven't you?
Exactly.
So you've had some traction elsewhere and you're hoping to get traction in Brighton. So what's been your success story so far outside of Brighton?
So the campaign launched in 2015. We've had quite a lot of different results. Lewis District, for example, went pesticide-free in 2017. So since then, they've been using a non-chemical alternative called foam stream, which essentially is hot water, and you use hot water to kill the plant. It's 99.9% hot water and then just a tiny bit of a totally organic substance, which makes it more effective. So Lewis District has done it. Then we've had a slew of results in the last few months, actually. So we've had Bristol have done it, Trafford outside Greater Manchester, Hammersmith and Fulham in London went totally pesticide-free in 2016. So we've had about 30 local authorities around the country take action of some sort, and we're really hoping that's going to spread across the whole of the UK.
Great. What are the downsides to pesticides? Because that's becoming a bit clearer now, isn't it? I mean, I myself, as we were saying off air, have used pesticides before.
Mm.
But there's a lot of downsides to them nowadays, aren't there?
There are, exactly. I mean, there are two main downsides, really. One is around the health impacts, and that there's been shown to have a lot of links between the chemicals that are being used and serious conditions like Parkinson's, like cancer. In particular, there's been a link to be shown between Roundup, which is the most commonly used weed killer in the world and in Brighton, and that's been shown to be linked to a type of cancer called non-Hodgkin's lymphoma.
Yeah.
But also less sort of chronic illnesses like asthma, depression, a whole host of health problems. And worryingly, the vulnerable people like children, the elderly and pregnant women tend to be most at risk from these health impacts. On the other side, you've got the environmental impact. So we've all seen the reports coming out recently about insect declines. We know that 40% of insects are now at risk, with 30, I think it's a quarter endangered. We've seen hedgehog numbers drop by 97% since the 1950s. And a large part of that is pesticide use. So, you know, there's a lot of pesticides used in agriculture. So our countryside is really covered in chemicals.
Yeah.
And wildlife is increasingly seeking refuge in towns and cities. And there's a really important role to play in urban areas towards biodiversity and encouraging wildlife into towns and cities and making it a safe haven for them.
Okay, just briefly, are pesticides a reason for our declining bee population? Is there a link to that? Because obviously that is really key, they're a key part of our ecosystem, aren't they? So.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the link between pesticides and bees is very, very well documented. And it's not just bees, it's all pollinators, including butterflies.
Yeah.
But they're obviously the things we rely on to pollinate our food.
Yeah.
So, you know, the saying goes, if we lose the bees, they're taking us with us.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so how can people find out more information?
So there's loads of information on our website. We're actually being supported by local businesses across Brighton, and that number's growing. So if people want to get our postcards, which they can sign and we'll send them to the candidates, they can go to Infinity Supermarket, we're taking over the Lush shop this weekend, Hisby, and a whole growing number of local businesses. They can also go to our website, and on the homepage they'll see a link to the campaign, and in 1 minute they can put in their postcode if they live in Brighton and Hove and email all the candidates directly.
Yeah.
We've already have 45 candidates pledge, which is around 20% of the total. We're hoping by election day we can make that 100%, and then whichever party wins control of Brighton and Hove Council, they will make the city pesticide free.
Great. And so ultimately you're looking to get this into I mean, manifestos have been published, but we're really looking for an almost a cross-party approach, a kind of a pledge. Whoever gets in power will kind of implement your this policy.
Exactly, and actually this area doesn't tend to be party political, so in some boroughs we've seen, you know, the Conservatives be great on it, in other ones Labour, yeah. You know, the Greens obviously generally are supportive. You would think so, but it's not a party political issue, so whoever gets into power, they should be putting the health of the residents and of the environment first.